Hello students, welcome to the EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Ashok Sharma, Assistant Professor and DBT Ramalinga Swami Fellow in Department of Biochemistry, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, India. Today I am going to talk about modules, role of carriers in ion transport from paper membrane transport. Ions are charged molecules and cannot easily diffuse through nonpolar phospholipid bilayer membrane of cells. Whereas small molecules, example oxygen, and nonpolar molecules, example steroid hormones, can easily diffuse across the nonpolar membranes down their concentration gradient. Similarly, like ions, large polar molecules like glucose cannot freely diffuse across the membrane down their concentration gradient. Diffusion across membrane requires molecules to be transported to get dissolved in the nonpolar phospholipid bilayer membrane and then pass through it. To dissolve in a particular medium, the nature of the solute must complement the nature of solvent. Example, sugar can get dissolved in water but fail to dissolve in oil. Both water and sugar being polar complementary to each other by forming interactions and dissolve sugar in water, whereas oil is nonpolar and interactions cannot be established between polar sugar and nonpolar oil and sugar fail to dissolve. Simple, like dissolve like. So, it does not mean that ions and polar molecules are completely trapped on one side of the membrane and cannot move across the membrane. They are transported by some other routes which provide them energy to break their hydrogen cell and move across the membrane. For the transport of charged ion and polar molecules like carrier and channels, in other words, we call transporters, are present in the biological system. In this module, our major focus is to study how ions are transported across the membrane via carriers. Thus, in this section, you will learn about the different role of carriers in ion transport, ionophores, detailed structure and function of carrier ionophores, example, valinomycin, and channel forming ionophores gramicidin A. So, the objective of today modules, first we learnt like mechanism of transport of molecules across membrane and what are different classes of the carrier proteins, what are ionophores, how ion channels distinguish between different ions, about selectivity of the ion channels and importance of selectivity of these ion channels during membrane transport, and structure and mechanism of action of valinomycins and its significance for proteinaceous carrier. And finally, we also study the structure and mechanism of action of the gramicidin and its significance. So, transport of molecules across membrane, small molecules and nonpolar molecules diffuse across the nonpolar membrane down their concentration gradient. The ions are charged molecules, cannot diffuse nonpolar phospholipid bilayer. So, transport of charged ion and polar molecules, carrier and channels which are present in the biological system are play crucial role. So, transporter present in the biological system, we are classified generally in two class. First, carrier, second, channels. These are exemplified by two important ionophores. Ionophores generally ion carriers produced by the microorganisms. First is the valinomycin, which is a carrier, and second is the gramicidin, which is act as a channel. Now we differentiate the carrier and channels. This table gives a detailed information about how carriers are different from the channels. The example of channels is potassium channel, and GLUT1, which is a glucose transporter, is a good example of carriers. Channels are intermittently are open, but carriers are never be open. And when potassium channels are working, then they are opening help to transport that particular kind of ions. But their cyclic conformational changes are happen during carrier protein mechanism. The channels have the capacity to translocate 6 into 10 to power 4 particles per events, but carriers only 1 to 5 particles translocated per events. And particles translocated per second by the channels is much more, around 10 to power 4 to 10 to power 8 when it's open. But carriers only have the capacity to translocate 200 to 50,000 particles per second. Carrier proteins. So basically, carrier proteins act as a carrier, are too large to move across the membrane. These are the transmembrane protein and with fixed topology. The good example of carrier protein is a GLUT1. GLUT1 is a carrier for glucose. So it carries the glucose in plasma membrane of various cells including erythrocytes. GLUT1 is a large integral protein predicted by hydropathy plots to include 2L transmembrane alpha helix. Carrier proteins are classified into three classes: uniport, symport, and antiport, as shown in this figure. Uniport carriers basically play an important role in facilitated diffusion, and these mediate the transport of a single solute. The example of uniport carrier is a GLUT1, which is a carrier for glucose molecules. Another example of uniport carrier is ionophore valinomycin, is a also uniport carrier. Another carrier class of carrier protein is symport. Symport, as name indicate, is a co-transport. Means this type of carrier molecules bind to two dissimilar solute or substrate and transport them together across a membrane, as shown in this figure. A and B are two different substrate which are transported collectively through the membrane. Transport of these two solute is obligatorily coupled, and a gradient of one substrate, usually an ion, may drive the uphill transport of co-substrate. It is sometimes also called the secondary active transport. They are good. Some examples, some symport are glucose sodium symport in the plasma membrane, present in some epithelial cells. And another example is the bacterial lactose primase, which is a proton symport carrier. The third class of carrier protein is antiport, as name suggests, antiport, like exchange the molecules through diffusion, exchange diffusion. So this type of carriers exchange one solute for another across the membrane. As shown this figure, solute A is going to exchange with solute B through the plasma membrane. Usually antiports exhibit ping-pong kinetics, and substrate is bind and is transported. Then another substrate bind and is transported in the other direction. So only exchange is catalyzed, no net transport is happened. The carrier proteins cannot undergo any kind of conformational transition in the absence of bound substrate. Let's we discuss another example of antiport carriers. So adenine nucleotide translocase is catalyze the translocation of ADP with ATP in 1-to-1 ratio. Here, exchange of ATP for ATP across the inner mitochondrial membrane happen with the help of enzyme adenine transnucleotide translocase. This is the good example of antiport carrier. This figure shows the active transport. Active transport pump may be uniporter or antiporter. Here, active transport enzyme couple the net solute movement across the membrane to ATP hydrolysis. When substrate side 1 to side 2 is translocated, 1 ATP molecules are utilized and hydrolyzed into the ADP and phosphate molecules. So, ATP dependent ion pumps are grouped into class based on transport mechanism as well as genetics and structural homology. These ATP dependent ion pumps include P class pump, F class like F1, F0 ATPase, which is present in the mitochondria and related to V class pump. Other one is the ABC. ABC is generally called ATP binding cassette. So ABC transporters generally catalyze transmembrane movement of various organic compound, including amphiphatic lipids and many drugs will not be discussed here. P-class ion pumps, basically these are the gene family exhibiting the Schwann's homology, and these P-class ion pump having the two type of pumps, sodium potassium ATPase pump and proton potassium ATPase pump. Sodium potassium ATPase is the plasma membrane of the most animal cells, is an antiport pump, and this pump is catalyzed the ATP dependent transport of sodium ions out of a cells in exchange of the potassium ion entering. Potassium hydrogen proton ATPase, basically this pump is involved in acidic secretion in the stomach as an antiport pump, and this is catalyzed the transport of proton out of the gastric parietal cells toward the stomach lumen in exchange of the potassium ions entering in the cells. The third class of P pumps is the calcium ATPase, which are generally present in the endoplasmic reticulum and plasma membrane and catalyze the ATP dependent translocation calcium ion away from the cytosol into the endoplasmic reticulum lumen. Some evidence also indicating that these pumps are antiport and transporting protons in the opposite direction, and calcium ATPase pump function to keep cytosolic calcium ions low, allowing calcium to serve as a signal molecules. So next we look out what are the role of carriers in ion transport. Ion carrier transport ions across the membrane down their concentration gradient, thus dissipating the concentration gradient. These ion carriers are used as antibiotic, thus acting against life, and these ions carriers are also known as ionophores. So ionophores we classify into class carrier ionophores and channel forming ionophores. So what are ionophores? Basically, ionophores are the proteins that bind to an ion reversibly and transport the bound ion across membrane. So lipid soluble biomolecules generally forming the hydrophobic core to capture ion in its center. So hydrophobic exterior interact with nonpolar bilayer membrane and facilitate ion transport through ionophores. Now question arises, how ion channels distinguish between the different ions? So there are two properties are there. One, selectivity of the charge. Second, selectivity for size. In selectivity for charge, generally negative charge group at the mouth of the channel can attract cations and push away anions. So, positively charged group at the mouth of the channel can attract anions and push away cation. Second is the selectivity for size. The diameter of the pore could determine the size of the particle that can pass. Interestingly, channels with 6, 5 and 4 transmembrane domain were found. Here, there are some pictures of the different channels like gap junction, which phi angle is 1.5 to 2 nanometer. Unspecific cation channels are phi is 0.6 nanometer and voltage dependent cation channels have 0.3 to 0.5 nanometer. So, potassium ion travel naked through their channels. These are the potassium channels where sodium ion travel together with the water molecules as on this figure. So, naked sodium ions are not stabilized in potassium channels. So, they cannot strip off their hydrate cells. Potassium ion with water molecules are too big to pass sodium channel. Their naked form is not stabilized either in this channel. So, question arises, why membrane transport becomes selective? So, there are a lot of importance that about selectivity of the membrane transport. Some of the important biological processes which require ion gradients are as follow, which need the selectivity of the membrane transport. For example, like nerve impulse, transmission generally required sodium, potassium and calcium ion gradient. And similarly, in muscles contractions, which required sodium, potassium and calcium gradient. During energy production in mitochondria via oxidative phosphorylation is required the potassium ion gradient. And in the lysosomal activity, in the lysosomes, which also require the potassium ion gradient. And another good example of selectivity of the membrane transport is calcium ions, which is very important we need for the signal transactions across the different membrane. So, all these factors suggest that the selective nature of transport across membrane is essential to maintain these gradient. So, carrier ionophores. Carrier ionophores bind to an ions on one side of the membrane in its central hydrophilic core and get dissolved in the nonpolar membrane with the help of its hydrophobic exterior. Means inside is the hydrophilic core where the ions are there and outside is the hydrophobic exterior. And it crosses the membrane and releases the ion on the other side of the membrane and comes back to the other side to start a new cycle of the transport. The good example of carrier ionophores is the valinomycin. So, valinomycin is a very classical good example of the mobile carrier. This is obtained from the streptomyces strains. And this is natural, neutral, cyclic ionophores which is consist of L-valine and D-alpha hydroxyisovaleric acid and L-lactic acid. The structure of valinomycin, which is an ion carrier, is fully illustrated by Isabella Carley. Valinomycin is a dodecadepsipeptide and a depsipeptide. Means a molecule, depsipeptide means a molecule with both peptide and ester bonds, having the both peptide and ester bonds. The structure places several carbonyl oxygen in the center of the ring structures and potassium and other ion coordinating with the oxygen present in the ring structure. Valinomycin potassium complex diffuses freely and rapid across the membrane. It is a detailed structure of valinomycin. Here we see L-valine, dehydroxyisovaleric acid, D-valine and L-acetic acid. And right hand side showing the cyclic structure of the valinomycin. Here isopropyl and methyl group which is present on outside of the cyclic structure required for solvation in the nonpolar solvent. And core of the valinomycin, which is lined by polar group of amino acids that help to bind in an ion which is facilitate its transportation. 25. Why selectivity of valinomycin is needed? There are flowing factors which are responsible, which help to elucidate why selective valinomycin needed. First, potassium and rubidium ion bind tightly, but affinity for sodium and lithium ion are about a thousandfold lower. Second, the radius of the ion is important factor which is going to consideration. Third one is the hydration analysis. Hydration is another factor for needed to solvation, to calculate the solvation energies, and it cost more energetically to dissolve sodium ion and lithium ion than potassium ion. So why potassium is preferred over sodium ions? If you look out flowing parameters, which clearly give the information why potassium are preferred. If you look out the central cavity, which has a radius about 1.33 angstroms, and the radius of the sodium ion is 0.95 angstrom, and it is too small to occupy the central channel efficiently and form a proper ionic bond. So these excluding the possibility of sodium ion binding and transportation, while in potassium ion, which have appropriate radius and it can be fit into the channel of valinomycins. So this size exclusion make the valinomycin is 10,000 times more specific for potassium transport than sodium transport. Why potassium ion is preferred over sodium ions? As we know, the center of the valinomycin is hydrophilic core has 6 carbonyl group of valine forming octahedral coordination with ion, can interact with monovalent and bind to it. But still, potassium ions is preferred over sodium ion. The reason behind its specificity is the size and shape of the valinomycin. The central cavity of the valinomycin has radius about 1.33 angstrom and sodium having radius of 0.9 5 angstrom is too small to occupy the central channel efficiently and form proper ionic bond. Thus, excluding the possibility of sodium binding and transportation, potassium ion having the appropriate radiation can fit into the channel of valinomycins. So this size exclusion make valinomycin is about more than 10,000 times more specific for potassium ion transport than sodium ion transport. During the mechanism of transportation of potassium ions, here in this figure you look out the puckering of the ring which make the hydrogen bonding and stabilize them, which allow the valinomycin to closely surround a single unhydrated potassium ion. And 6 oxygen atoms, which is present in the ion of 4, these 6 oxygen atoms interact with the bound potassium ions and replacing oxygen atom of water or by hydrogen. So the smaller sodium ion cannot simultaneously interact with all 6 oxygen atoms with valinomycin. So thus this situation is energetically is less favorable for sodium ion to set its water of hydration to form a complex with valinomycin. The interior of the valinomycin potassium complex is polar, the surface of the complex is hydrophobic. So this allow valinomycin to enter the lipid core of the bilayer to solubilize potassium ion within the hydrophobic milieu. This cartoon picture basically representing the mechanism of transport of iron via valinomycins. Figure A representing the potassium, iron and valinomycin complex ball and stick model. In the center, blue color representing the potassium ions, and outside is the 6-octahedral structure of the valinomycin molecules. Right hand side, it representing the how potassium ion are transported across the membrane. The potassium ion which is present exterior side of the cells are coupled with the valinomycins and facilitate to transport in throughout through the plasma membranes, and it enter into the interior cell interior of the cells. So valinomycin bind to the potassium on one side of the membrane and carry it to the other side of the membrane. Because we know that valinomycin is a passive carrier for potassium ion, it can bind or release the potassium when it encounter the membrane surface. Valinomycin can cause the net potassium transport because it can translocate either in the complex or uncomplex state, and the direction of net flux is depend on the electrochemical potassium gradient as shown in this figure. Now we discuss the biological role. These act as a neurotoxicants, means it dissipate the ion gradient required for the nerve impulse transmissions. These also destroy the ion gradient. So these can be used as an antibiotic, or it also act as a non-metallic potassium selective electrode. So these are the important biological role of valinomycins. Ion channels are transmembrane proteins that form a hollow pore in the membrane, which facilitates the transport of the charged ion across the membrane by providing a polar path in the non-polar membrane. They can permit ions fluxes about 10 to power 6 to 10 to power 7 molecules per second. The ion channels we can classify into two types based on the nature of ions they transport, like cation channels and anion channels. Cation channels have negative charge present within them and thus make interactions with the cations and transport them. The permeability of a channel depends upon three features of ions: size, extent of hydrogen, and extent of charge density. Cation channels basically have three regions, like cytoplasmic region, transmembrane region, and extracellular region, as shown in this figure. The transmembrane region in most of the channel have alpha helix domain, which form a pore in which the central cavity is lined by charged group, which are responsible for transport of the ions. The channels basically undergo open and close conformation during transport of the ions, and these channels are very selective, in most cases permitting the passage of only one type of ion, like sodium ions, calcium ions, etc. So ion channels can be further classified into three categories: leaky channels, gated channels, and ligand gated channels or voltage gated channels. The leaky channels, basically ions can freely move across these channels down their concentration gradient. In gated channels, these channels are not always open. They certain signaling and thus can be regulated. Similarly, in ligand gated channels, these are specific. These channels are responsible for specific molecules bind to the receptor and open the channels. And voltage gated channels generally open or close in response to change in the membrane potential. So the good example of ion channel is a gramicidine. Now we discuss the gramicidine. These are the good classical example of the channel ionophores. This compound is extracted from the Bacillus brevis, and it is has a linear structure which is made of 15 residue peptides, have the alternating D and L forms. This compound have double helical structure in organic solvent, while end-to-end helical dimer structure in the water, and sometimes unusual helix like 6.3 residue per ton with the center hole and 0.4 nanometers. And the ion migrate through the central pore. Gramicidin has two conformations. The gramicidin channel is a dimer, and two conformations have been proposed. First, double helical dimer in which two chains are coiled, a common axis, and second is a helical dimer is formed by head-to-head association of two gramicidin monomers as shown in this figure. This is the PDB file of the gramicidin dimer. Gramicidin is an open chain polypeptide with 15 amino acid residues in which D and L forms are alternatively present in the sequence. In lipid bilayer membrane, gramicidin dimerize and fold as a right-handed beta helix, and dimer just span within the bilayers. The primary structure of gramicidin generally made of hydrophobic amino acids, and both peptides, as you see here, are blocked by modification. The gramicidin generally has a primary structure is linear, but forms three-dimensional ion conducting channel in the membrane. The outer surface of the gramicidin dimer, which interact with the core of the lipid bilayer, is hydrophobic, means it repels the water molecules, and the ions which pass through the more polar lumen of the helix. The ion flow through the individual gramicidin channels can be observed if small number of gramicidin molecules is present in lipid bilayer separating two compartments containing salt solutions. The proposed mechanism of gramicidin gating. Basically, this model is consistent with the finding that high gramicidin overall transport rate is depend on the gramicidin. The opening and closing of the channels, like that is called gating of the gramicidin channel, is thought to involve reversible dimerizations. And open channel form when two gramicidin molecules join end to end to the span of the membrane as shown in this figure. When these are individual, they are closed. The gramicidin is very selective channel for the potassium over sodium, and its permeability ratio is about 2.9. Gramicidin channels play very important biological roles. It acts as a topical antibiotic. When we apply on the skin, will not cause damage to skin of majority case, but its internal application cannot be done at its cause hemolysis and then bacterial cell death. And these molecules also cause the cell death by changing the cellular cation content, principally potassium ion instead of sodium ion. So, students, let's now summarize what we have learned from in this module. Ions are the charged molecules that cannot pass the lipid membrane as they cannot dissolve into the non-polar membrane. They require special transport system which facilitate the transport of the ion across membrane. There are two type of ions. Transporters, ion channel A, ion carrier B. Channels, as name suggest, form a pore in a membrane which provide ions a polar path for transport across the membrane. Whereas ion carrier form a complex with the transporting ion. Ion carrier will bound to the ion on one side of the membrane, where its concentration is high, and then transport it to the other side of the membrane where ion concentration is low. So, valinomycin is an ion carrier which bind to the potassium and dissipate its concentration gradient across the membrane. Similarly, gramicidine is an ion channel and it also dissipates the concentration gradient across the membrane. So these type of transporter are also known as ionophores. Both of them are used as antibiotic as they dissipate the electrochemical gradient essential for life. Thank you.